In the course of evolution, we've evolved into a species for whom symbols, ideas, and abstractions are as real as the physical world. We live immersed in an ocean of ideas. This preoccupation with abstract symbols is the foundation of human culture. And culture is what makes us different. Culture is the edifice that's composed of science, religion, magic, myth, medicine, technology, folklore, law, and so on. This is what sets us apart from every other species, even the primate species in nature. It's also clear that were it not for our extremely complicated, overexpressed in some ways, brain that is the generator of language, culture would not exist. It's because we have this extraordinarily complex brain that we have culture. How did this come about? Well, obviously through the vicissitudes of evolution. If you look at this interesting diagram, this is a timeline of neural evolution. Millions of years on this axis and the cranial capacity in centimeters on this axis. And what is probably the take-home lesson here is that in a mere 2 million years, which is a blink of an eye in terms of evolutionary time, the brains of primates have tripled in size and complexity. Homo habilis, starting around 800 centimeters, Homo erectus, our immediate evolutionary progenitors, only about 1100 centimeters. Homo erectus in the pageant of hominid evolution is the most successful species so far. They lived almost 2 million years. The Homo erectus disappeared at about 100,000 years ago, about the same time that Homo sapiens and our contemporary species, Homo neanderthalensis, showed up. Modern humans have only been around for about 100,000 years. Compared to the success of Homo erectus and the way things are going, I think it's unlikely that we're going to match that, although we can always hope. So how did this situation come about, this rapid complexification of the human brain? However it happened, we ended up as what I like to call the problematic primate. We're problematic in a number of ways. We have this hypertrophied brain. We have complex language. We're capable of symbolic thinking. We're creative and artistic. We're also aggressive and warlike and creative about making war. We are a technological species. We also have a religious and spiritual aspect to us. We're extremely clever as a species. We're not very wise. This is part of the problem that we find ourselves currently in. And that's part of the challenge that we face. We are, in evolutionary terms, the most dangerous thing to show up in the evolutionary pageant since life existed on Earth. We're also the most promising development. It may be our only hope that our smartness, our intelligence that got us into this mess is going to get us out of this mess. If our ass is going to be saved, it will not be done by stupid people, unlike what some politicians might want you to believe. So let's put that in our pocket for a minute and talk about plants. All plants are fantastic chemists, and this because they have mastered this process of photosynthesis. They've developed light harvesting pigments that can capture energy from the sun and bind it into the processes of the biosphere. You can think of the biosphere as an organism. The entire planet is like a cell. And it's because plants can capture energy from the solar system and use that to make an enormous variety of organic molecules using only the power of the sun, water, and carbon dioxide. And conveniently enough, they are the main thing that is sequestering carbon dioxide out of the atmosphere. It's plants that maintain the delicate balance of CO2 in the atmosphere, which we are rapidly undermining Also, incidentally and conveniently for us breathing people, it happens to produce oxygen as a byproduct. So plants are pretty important. This is kind of what I mean when I say plants are really running the show. They really are running the show because life depends on them. And this process of photosynthesis, sun energy, CO2, and water, it uses the energy of the sun to ionize water, and it uses that reductive capability to produce a vast variety of organic compounds. Most of these are just the molecules of life. They're more or less universal, things like nucleic acids and amino acids, lipids, and proteins, and so on. But plants also make a vast variety of chemicals that don't occur in all plants. They're sometimes called secondary compounds, things like alkaloids, for example. What do they do with these alkaloids? They're not essential for life, but plants make them. So what is their purpose? They must serve some purpose because plants, nothing in nature really wastes effort. Well, it turns out that these secondary compounds, especially the alkaloids, you can think of them in some ways, they're messenger molecules. Plants interact with their environment through chemistry, not behavior. Plants substitute biosynthesis for behavior. And these secondary metabolites are messenger molecules. They are the language of plants that plants use to interact with everything else in their environment that they have to interact with, such as fungi and microorganisms in the soil, insects, of course. All the pollination relationships are chemically mediated through millions of years of coevolution. Herbivores, things that might want to nibble on plants, and of course that includes us. And these messenger molecules have multiple functions. For example, they might be defensive compounds. But more interestingly, they're signaling compounds, and they often are involved in the initiation of symbiosis. Symbiosis is a close relationship, a close cooperative relationship with organisms of different species, often for mutual benefit. And that is the basis of evolution. Evolutionary biologists are beginning to re-understand that it's not so much competition as cooperation that drives evolution forward. And plants mediate this process through this vast array of secondary compounds. So you can think of these things as messenger molecules. And think of us evolving as primates, evolving in a world of plant biodiversity and chemical biodiversity. You can think of it almost as a chemical ecology. You've got secondary compounds in plants, that we are exposed to through dietary processes. And this has effects on both the phenotype, in terms of our adaptation, phenotypic adaptations such as recognition or avoidance, development of detoxification technologies, activation of physiological mechanisms on the individual level to adapt to one's diet. This is why we're all biochemical individuals. Also on the genotypic level, there are modifications in gene expression in relation to the chemical environment that we inhabit. This initiates variations in diverse metabolic processes, modifications in disease susceptibility, for example, changes in individual and group biological fitness, and essentially shifts in gene frequency. Ultimately, that's what it results in. So that is the situation that humans evolved to this state of high complexity. And the thesis is that it was the secondary compounds in these plants that had a great deal to do with that. So if you go back now to the brain, and we can talk about messenger molecules, neurotransmitters are the brain's messenger molecules, just as these secondary compounds are messenger molecules. Most of our critical biochemical functions in the brain are mediated by this neuronal communications network. And the neurotransmitters that we find in the brain and the compounds that we find in plants are similar because they all evolved from similar precursors. In fact, in many cases, they're identical. Neurotransmitters like serotonin, for example, are quite widespread in plants and also very important, as we know, in the brain. So this is a reflection of that. And Salvador Dali was asked what was the origin of his ideas for his surrealistic art. He was asked, were you taking drugs? He said, no, I am drugs. And if you think about it, that's true. We're biochemical engines that run on drugs. Neurotransmitters, hormones, enzymes, all of those things are drugs in a sense. They just happen to be drugs that we make in our own bodies. So it's not surprising that when you ingest drugs from outside, they have effects on these internal signal transduction processes that being curious primates with the complex brains, we sometimes find interesting, to say the least. Things like this, for example, psilocybin from the magic mushroom. Magic mushrooms were very widespread in the early tropics. The species of mushroom here is the pan-tropical psilocybin mushroom. And this molecule is everywhere in the environment. So if these are messenger molecules and they're sending a message to our species, what is that message? What is that message? Symbiosis, baby. Plants and other things in the environment want to form symbioses with the human species. It's to their advantage for us to take them under our wing and to form relationships with them, because then we protect them from the vicissitudes of natural selection. And at the same time, we subject them to the effects of artificial selection, which is sometimes not even that pretty. But for the plants, it is an evolutionary free ride, at least until the point where we manage to completely destroy the planet. And you know, we're working on it. But for now, it's good. And symbiosis and the messenger molecules in these sacred plants like psilocybin have a few other messages for us. One thing, wake up, you monkeys, you're wrecking the place. And this is a message that many people are getting these days from these sacred plants. And you monkeys only think you're running the show, which again is true, because plants are actually sustaining life on us. And if plants went away, life on Earth could not exist. If we went away, probably everything else in the biosphere would heave a big sigh of relief. And also, never forget how little we know. As scientists, it's important to be cognizant of the limitations in our knowledge. Because sometimes we can be arrogant. We can think we have it all figured out. We have only a tiny, tiny part of a reality figured out. And another thing that probably should be on this slide but isn't is, never forget that we are monkeys. So most people will recognize this if you're old enough. This is the monolith from 2001, and it kind of stands in as a symbol for, it is something that appeared out of nowhere in evolution. It was completely incomprehensible, it was totally alien, it was utterly terrifying, and it was fascinating. So it's a symbol for what Rudolf Otto has called the mysterium tremendum, the mysterious, tremendous, incomprehensible mystery. And in the movie, it appears at critical junctures in human evolution and human history to kind of nudge us forward in terms of our cognitive evolution. Well, it's a nice concept, but we don't really have to go to Jupiter to find this catalyst. This catalyst has been present in nature since the earliest times. Not as dramatic as a monolith, just kind of quietly existing in the environment until some hungry primate stumbles on it and says, this looks good, I think I'll eat some. Doesn't taste too bad, maybe I'll eat some more. All of a sudden, you have the mysterium tremendum fully manifest, with all the consequences that leads to. So It led to the founding of shamanism. Shamanism is essentially a technique that we had to invent in order to deal with the transpersonal realms that these molecules made accessible, and also religion. Religion was founded based on the perception of another reality, a transcendent reality that was populated by interesting intelligences and was the source of mystery and wonder. One of the more recent instantiations of this, of course, is the mysteries of Eleusis, one of the last Mediterranean mystery religions that was based on ecstasy. They were goddess-based religions, and they were based on the consumption of these plants, such as mushrooms, containing these messenger molecules. And in these religions, these were the characteristics that Roland and other people have characterized so well using science. Mystical experiences, a direct experience of a transcendent other. The mysterium tremendum, a sense of oceanic boundlessness. We are all one, right? Apprehension of the unity of all existence. These experiences are transformative and profoundly meaningful for us today, and they were for early hominids as well. And the mysteries of Eleusis were the last of these psychedelic ecstasy religions, but their roots stretch back to the Paleolithic. In this diagram here, in this bas relief from Eleusis, it shows what is described as a flower being given to by Demeter to her daughter Persephone, who went, you remember, through the underworld. And I'm not sure how they get a flower out of this. Anyway, I guess archaeologists will go to some lengths to avoid seeing what's right in front of them. I have to also say, you know, now psilocybin has come around again after thousands of years. Now it turns out it's the best tool that we have for understanding the neurobiology of mystical experiences. And work by my esteemed colleague, Roland Griffiths, and Franz Wohlenweider, and other people, we can now study mystical experiences, and as an experimental, we can reliably replicate mystical experiences. Using these compounds, we can measure states of mind, and then using cool technologies like neuroimaging, we can actually open a window onto the brain while it's having a mystical experience and see just what is going on, what parts of the brain are activated when you have that. So this is a tremendous advance. This brings something that is, so for many people they never have one, for some people they hope all their lives to have one. Now you can reliably induce a mystical experience with 20 milligrams of psilocybin and the right set and setting, and of course the right therapist. So this is an advance in the understanding of what you might call the neuroscience of the sacred. Other features of the psilocybin and psychedelic experience as general, what you come away with is a sense of biophilia, a love of life, a love for living things. We have a sort of innate attraction to all that is alive. It's just built into human nature. Another one, animism. The idea that most indigenous peoples have the worldview that non-human entities, all non-human entities, animals, plants, even weather and rocks, have some kind of an inherent spiritual essence. And pantheism. The idea that the divine is nature. There is no God outside of nature. Nature is the God. God is nature waking up to itself. Nature itself instantiates the idea of the divine. So this is what you might call the indigenous worldview, or in some ways the psychedelic worldview. There's a great deal of overlap here. Mystical experience, biophilia, animism, pantheism. This is the indigenous and or psychedelic worldview. And these are not belief systems. These are actually empirical observations of the nature of reality, seen through the lens of these sacred medicines. And interestingly enough, this perspective is closer to the current perspectives of modern science than some of the more reductionist perspectives that are accepted. Well, and then things changed at some point. The so-called Abrahamic religions, Judaism, Christianity, and then later Islam, showed up about the time that the Goths invaded and sacked the Temple of Demeter in 396 AD. This effectively ended the Bronze Age psychedelic mystery religion. Christianity had been accepted as the state religion some centuries before this. But the Abrahamic religions had a very different perspective on spirituality and salvation that the pagan, that was almost antithetical to the pagan perspective on human life and spirituality. In their perspective, God and nature were considered separate. God was this judgmental, paternal, fully external entity. And if there was ever a goddess in the picture, that was lost in this perspective. Salvation and revelation were understood to be external to nature. Humans were not to be thought of as part of nature. Nature is subordinate to humanity. It's something that we own. It's something for us to exploit and use and then leave depleted, almost like rape, in fact. In fact, it is rape. Humanity is specifically instructed to rule over and subdue the earth. This was the perspective that the Abrahamic traditions brought. We lost this notion that it's okay to be biological. Many of these religions are essentially denials of biology, denials of the fact that we are biochemical engines, we're biochemical beings, and we have a corporeal existence. So then this led the pantheism, gave rise to monotheism, the idea that there's only one God, and that God exists outside of nature, it's not part of nature. Animism gave way to devaluation of nature. We were taught that only man has a spiritual nature. There's no inherent spiritual value in nature. We shouldn't worry about it. It's just here for us to use. Mystical experiences gave way to doctrines and dogma. Actual individual mystical experiences was forbidden. Only the priests get to interpret it, and then they'll tell the believers what they should believe. So you can't have direct experience of the divine under these frameworks. Biophilia, the inherent love of life, the love of being alive, gave way to, if I dare say it, necrophilia. Christianity is focused on suffering, sin, and death. This is what we're taught. The West is preoccupied, is the Christian tradition, and all of these Abrahamic traditions are preoccupied with suffering and death. In some sense, this perspective has poisoned the Western mind, and by that poisoned the rest of humanity. We are taught that we're inherently flawed beings. We're born into sin. Christ died for our sin. We need a Messiah to save us. Our salvation will be found in heaven, not on earth. So don't care about earth. Don't worry about taking care of the earth. That's what we're taught. We have to reject the world as inherently evil. We live only to suffer and to die. Great perspective, right? I want to join that religion. And now, 2,000 years on, we're witnessing the consequences of this attitude. We have poisoned the earth. We're raping the earth. We're poisoning it. We are exploiting it. We're even criminalizing it. We're destroying it. Is this any way to treat our mother? Because our mother is the earth. So we're at a critical historical juncture now. We're approaching what you might call the end of history, the end of our historical journey. It started in prehistory, and history is something that's linear. It's something that ends. We're now in what might be called what some people call the Anthropocene. It's the current geological period where human activities have a powerful effect on the global environment. We're very busy deconstructing the Earth, as you can see here. Some have said we may be entering the Psychozoic era. And this term pertains to the period of geological time that's characterized by the presence of human intelligence. I don't think we've crossed the threshold yet, but maybe that's what we should be shooting for. I see many instances of human stupidity, not so much human intelligence, but maybe this is our challenge. We need to repair the damage that the Anthropocene has created, this idea that the Earth is something dead, it's something just to be torn apart and used for our purposes. We need to get over that, and we have basically two major tasks that we're faced with. First, we have to wake up. We have to wake up to what's happening. These medicines, these sacred plants, are the catalyst to help us do that. Once we wake up, then we have to wise up. We have to change the way that we're relating to nature. We have to become nurturers and lovers of nature, not exploiters and owners of nature. So at this particular historical juncture, I think we all agree here that we're all in a lot of trouble as a species, as a planet. We're the only species that can think about our own death. We're the only species that can anticipate the death of our planet and that can contemplate the end of nature. And as in this particular historical era, we become almost obsessed with the idea that nature is going to end, the world is going to end. These apocalyptic scenarios are rife in media and everywhere else in the cultural meme sphere. And that's because we can conceive of this and we're worried, you know, as well we should be, because we know that time is running out. When we have to quickly come up with solutions, come up with a re-understanding, we have to get wise fast. And these sacred medicines are catalysts for that purpose. They are the best hope we have. I think probably everyone in this room can agree, politics is broken. Technology is broken. Most of the institutions of humanity are broken. They are not bringing forth solutions. They're bringing forth ever more idiocy. So we have to start listening to the sacred plants, and we have to take to heart the message that they send us. So just as mushrooms may have been at the beginning of history, of human history, they may also be at the end of human history as we cross the threshold to some kind of ahistorical or post-historical existence. And the only question facing us is which mushroom? The choice is ours. Thank you.
My pleasure to introduce you, Roland. Many of us have come from psychedelics trying to sort of identify ourselves as outside the system and then moving into the system. And Roland is someone who's been inside the system and has moved out towards psychedelics. And he leads the incredible research team at Johns Hopkins that's doing all sorts of studies into spirituality and therapy in a wide range of contexts. So now it's my pleasure to introduce Roland Griffiths.
So it's a great pleasure to be here. This is the first time I've been to Prague, and I want to thank the organizers, and this is really quite an exciting meeting. So what I want to do today is talk about work that we've been doing on the psilocybin occasion mystical type experience. I'm going to focus primarily on its implications for spirituality and mention just at the very end implications for therapeutics. So just to acknowledge and to further the comment that Dennis made, this research has been primarily supported by the Heffter Research Institute, but also a variety of other private sector groups. And the National Institute on Drug Abuse has provided some funding for our work. This research that I'll discuss has been done at Johns Hopkins in Baltimore, and I also just want to acknowledge that I'm part of a dedicated and very talented research team. So I'm functioning as a figurehead now on the behalf of some very talented individuals that I work with at Hopkins. So the Hopkins Psilocybin Research Project started in 1999 with the development of our first study with psilocybin. And since that time, we have completed studies in healthy volunteers, in novice and long-term meditators. We're doing a study in religious professionals now. We've worked with psychologically distressed cancer patients and addicted cigarette smokers. In all, we've now treated about 270 participants, 560 sessions. Today, I want to focus primarily on spirituality and its consequences. And I'm going to review some of the studies in healthy volunteers and long-term meditators. I'll then tell you about some survey studies we've done. And I'll conclude just by mentioning our therapeutic studies. So, two studies that we initiated and did in healthy volunteers, both of which have been published. I'm going to just go through because it lays out how we conduct these studies, some of the measures that we take. So these were two double-blind, rigorous, controlled trials. One, we compared a high dose of psilocybin to methylphenidate. Another, we looked at psilocybin dose effects. And in all these studies, subjects are recruited from the general community. They're medically healthy, psychiatrically healthy, and importantly, they're without histories of hallucinogen use in these initial studies. So they're coming in as drug naive or hallucinogen naive. There are 54 total participants in these two studies, mean age 46, approximately half female, highly educated group of people, most college or postgraduate degrees, and most employed, either full-time or part-time. They meet with our session sitters or monitors or guides, depending on what term you want to use, for usually about 8 hours prior to the first session. The purpose of this is to build and develop rapport and trust, which is thought to minimize risks of adverse effects, challenging experiences. Sessions are conducted in a comfortable living room-like session room. Volunteers come in the morning, having fasted overnight. They take a capsule at about 9 o'clock in the morning. They're in the presence of two sitters throughout the day, and the volunteers are encouraged to lay down on the couch and use eye mask and headphones through which they listen to a program of music. They're encouraged to direct their attention inward on their inner experience. This isn't a psychotherapy session. And if fear or anxiety arise, the sitters are there just to provide reassurance. So under these conditions, this shows the monitor ratings of overall magnitude of drug effect in our dose effect study with psilocybin. And so this is the drug effect over time, over a 6-hour session. You can see we get very orderly dose and time-related effects of psilocybin with effects peaking at 2 to 3 hours. And it won't surprise you to know that under these conditions, the kinds of subjective effects that we get are those that are common to classic hallucinogens, of which psilocybin is a type. So there are perceptual changes, there's greater emotionality. Sometimes at low frequency, but these experiences can be fearful, and they're cognitive changes. But to me, in one of the focuses of our research, this is the most interesting, and that is that in most volunteers studied, psilocybin produced large increases on self-rated questionnaires designed to measure naturally occurring mystical experiences. So these were questionnaires initially designed and formulated around so-called spontaneous reports of mystical experiences. And so this shows dose-related increases. This is at the end of the day on the so-called, on the mystical experience questionnaire, which is a questionnaire that we have refined to measure these kinds of experiences. But you get nice dose-related increases in these mystical experiences. So what are they? We've heard from a number of people who have gone through these descriptive categories. So unity is the core feature. That's the interconnectedness of all people, things, all is one, pure consciousness. So that's the core feature of these experiences, and then it's accompanied by a sense of sacredness, this noetic quality of encountering ultimate reality, or the experience is more real than real, deeply felt positive mood, transcendence of time and space, and ineffability. These experiences are felt and reported to be indescribable. And the mystical experience questionnaire then has codified these features, and when we run something called factor analysis on a wide range of questions that probe these different dimensions, we come up with four factors. One factor is the first three of these, traits, the unity, sacredness, and noetic. They all lump together, and then there's mood, transcendence, and ineffability. So that's the mystical experience, but what's really interesting is the consequences of that mystical experience, and this gets to where I want to go in terms of its implication for spirituality and altruism. So 1 month after these sessions, you ask people, what was that session like? What's your memory? And people are endorsing at rates, you know, looking at like 80 to 90%, saying that it's among the five most personally meaningful and spiritually significant experiences of their entire lifetime, comparing it, say, to the birth of a firstborn child. 95% almost report increased sense of well-being. About 90% endorse positive mood changes. But beyond this, there are also remarkable positive changes in attitudes about life and self, positive mood changes, and again, to the point of what I want to emphasize, spirituality, altruism, and positive social effects. So this then underscores the personality is showing dose-related increases in the dose effect study a month after sessions in ratings of spirituality. And the kinds of things people are endorsing is this increased reverence, sacredness of life, gratitude for life, interconnectedness of all life, increased prayer or meditation, personal relationship with God of their understanding or ultimate reality, decreased apprehension about death. And likewise, altruism or positive social effects are increased. This is again a month later, with people reporting increased sensitivity, tolerance, and love of others, increased social concern and compassion, concern for vulnerable populations and a need for service to others, and decreased sense of hatred and negative expression of anger. So these effects I just showed you at 1 month are all sustained at 14 months and in fact, far longer than that, the 14-month time point is the furthest we've gone. And this is just illustrative of this sustaining of effects of ratings of increased personal well-being. So this is, this is 5 weeks after a high dose. You have 94% of people endorsing this, and 14 months later, it's just dropped a little bit. But that's true with all of these positive dimensions. They're sustained. Not only do people report themselves to be changed, their colleagues at work, family members, and friends also report that they have changed. So this isn't just in people's own interpretation. They're apparently acting and behaving in ways that other people can see. And we've shown that in a number of studies, in this case, community volunteers, and you're looking at 1 month follow-up and 14 month follow-up. The final point I want to make in this study of, in these studies of healthy volunteers, is the mystical type experiences post-session, immediately post-session, predict these positive outcomes 14 months later. So what we have here is a mysticism score. This is the equivalent to our mystical experience score. And looking at spiritual significance a year later. So the higher the mystical experience score at the end of the session, that predicts the ratings of spiritual significance or a variety of these altruism, a variety of these other positive effects 14 months later. And it's not just the magnitude of the psilocybin experience. So it's not just intensity. It has to do with the qualities of this mystical experience. That's there's something very intriguing about the nature of these experiences for being a proxy for whatever is going on in the brain and the cascade of biological and neurochemical consequences thereafter. Okay, switching gears now to meditation. So psilocybin and meditation, I believe, can be viewed as complementary techniques for exploration of the nature of mind and self. And neuroimaging studies show that meditation and psilocybin produce strikingly similar decreases in brain areas responsible for self-referential processing. I refer here to research by Judd Brewer and Robin Carhart-Harris in the default mode network. So the first study that I want to talk about is a study we did in novice meditators. This is a double-blind study examining whether psilocybin experiences can facilitate people's engagement in meditation and other spiritual practices, and thus increase spirituality and altruistic values. There were 75 participants in the study with little or no history of either meditation or psychedelic use. It was a 6-month study. It began with a 1 month meditation introduction. So we introduced them to meditation, gave them instructions, encouraged them to initiate this practice. And the agreement was that they would continue to meditate throughout the study. And this was followed by 2 psilocybin sessions separated at 1 month intervals and then a 6 month follow-up. Participants were randomized to 1 of 3 groups of 25 volunteers each. So it's a parallel group design. They were blinded to dose and some other aspects of the study. Group 1 gets a very low dose of psilocybin and relatively little low support. So we met with them only 6 times, but we gave them the strong encouragement to practice. Group 2 is just identical to group 1, except group 2 gets high doses of psilocybin on the 2 sessions. And group 3 also gets the high doses, but also high support for spiritual practice. So we're meeting with them 26 different times as individuals in groups throughout the study. And so now I'm going to focus on the 6-month follow-up data here. And this slide really shows what all the slides I'm going to show you illustrate. And that is, and this is spirituality at 6 months. So the low dose standard support is anchored here at 6 months. If you give a high dose of psilocybin in this identical context, you get large increases in spirituality. That fits with the data I just showed you. But it makes common sense, but I think it's indeed important nonetheless. If you combine the psilocybin with high support for spiritual practice, you get a further and significant increase in all these dimensions. So here's spirituality, here's altruism, this is positive social effects. Forgiveness, this is benevolence motivation, this is a trait level of forgiveness. Interpersonal closeness and daily spiritual experiences, all showing the same effect. So the study demonstrates these